you've got victory this morning. Listen, Paul said, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation." Thank God you're saved today. And if you're saved, you ought to look up and say, "Lord, thank you for being saved." You think it's hot out here today? God forbid we wake up on the other side of eternity in a place called hell. Hey, I'll rejoice this morning and know I'm saved this morning. How about you? So let's sing this morning, page 120. Sam, give us a little bit more juice up here so people can hear me. I'll do my best not to scream too much. But man, if I get shouted, if I get excited this morning, y'all pay me no mind. I love the Lord this morning. How about you? Victory in Jesus. Wait a minute, that's the wrong key. Sorry, a wrong tune. I'm excited already. See, I've already forgot.
I heard it all so real.
Wrong key.
Yeah.
I'm telling y'all, pray. The devil's doing his very best to kill, steal, and destroy. Someone needs to pray this morning. I'm telling you. He knows what God's trying to do in here this morning. Amen. Let's try this again. You can remain standing. That's totally up to you. We're going to turn to page 333, and you all know what that is.
Hillbilly theme song.
We're just going to call it the Centerburg Free Will Baptist theme song. I'll fly away. I don't know how you could stay seated when you sing this song thinking about heaven. Amen. One day we're going to fly away. Would you agree? And it's not going to be by coincidence. It's not going to be of anything that man does. But I'm telling you what, the Lord's coming back. You believe that? The Bible says he's coming back with a shout. And not only a shout, but the Bible says it'll be so loud that it'll wake the dead. And the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet him in the Lord. And there shall we ever be with the Lord. Listen to me. All of what we're faced with today, one day will be a thing of the past. You won't even remember it. But I'm looking forward to the day when Jesus comes to get his church. Let's sing this morning. Sing it now. Stand. Sing that last verse. Think about, and as you sing it, think about it. One day, well, I'm telling you, church, it could happen today. And you know what? It may not happen today, but I'm gonna be ready if it should happen today. Amen. Hey, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Today could be the day that this old song that we're singing right now could just shortly come to pass. Let's sing it all without music. Go ahead, girls. Last verse.
Go again. I need that chord again. Sorry. Well, just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end.
Seated. Someone said one time, I don't like clapping in church and I don't like people shouting in church. Well, I'm going to tell you what, you're not going to like heaven. Because right now, that's what they're doing. The angels in heaven's crying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. Bible says, matter of fact, that the angels in heaven rejoice over one sinner that repents. Thank God. I just wonder if someone isn't getting saved all the time all across this world. I have no idea, but if so, they're having a time in heaven. So you know what we ought to do? We ought to just have a time here in Centerburg. Amen. Thank God. God's still on the throne this morning. If you're lost, you still can be saved. If you're saved, you ought to rejoice knowing that your home's been made in heaven and God's prepared that place for you, and it won't be too much further along before you make your acquaintance with the Lord. Listen to me, friend. Right now we live by faith, but can I tell you, by the eye of sight, one day I will see Jesus face to face. My eyes shall behold him. Thank God. The one that come and died for the sins of the whole world. I'm looking forward to that day. How about you? Boy, I'm excited this morning in the Lord. Praise the Lord this morning. I'm going to call Brother Noah up. We're going to come to you this morning for the morning tithes and offering. Actually, you're going to come yourself if you want to give your offerings. We're not going to pass the offering plates. We want to keep people as comfortable as we can. They're up here on the altar. If you want to give, that's totally between you and the Lord. If you don't, that's between you and the Lord. You're not expected to give. But if you want to give, you go ahead and give this morning. Brother Mike, if you'll come to the altar or up here to the mic and ask God's blessing upon the offering this morning.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we're just so thankful, God, for allowing us to come to your house, Lord, to worship you in spirit and in truth this morning, God, Lord. And we're just thankful for the day, Lord, the beautiful weather that you've given us, God, Lord. But most importantly, we're thankful for your Son, Lord, that died on the cross for our sins. God, Lord, I just pray for this offering that will go for the uplifting of your kingdom. God, Lord, I pray that you bless those that had to give, Lord, and those that didn't. God, I pray, Lord, that if there's one here that's lost and undone without you, Lord, that today would be the day that they get things settled with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Got a song this morning. I've never sang this song before, so I need you all to pray for us. Sam, give me some juice here. Give us as much as you can, so I won't sing. So I can hear myself, I guess. Some of you'll know this song. I know Brother Jay will. I know Brother Mike will. I know that others will. But I was given some homework on vacation by a good friend of mine, and he asked if I'd sing this song and learn it. And you all know it, so I thought it's appropriate for what's happening in my life right now and in your life. You know, we look around and we see devastation. We see corruptness. We see deceitfulness. But you know, God's people don't have to live in defeat. I said God's people don't have to live in defeat. Listen, you and I've got a better place to go. The world doesn't. We have access to the throne of God. And you know, I got to thinking about how blessed that we are. Matter of fact, I just, for myself, I realize how blessed that I am. That God would even choose me. I didn't choose God. God chose me to serve him. That God chose me to have just a small part in what he's trying to do in this world. Now listen, if we all would get that mentality, that if we would just allow God to use us a little bit, could you imagine what God could accomplish? You all know the song when I sing it, so you all sing it. Never made a fortune. It's probably too late now. I don't have to worry about that much, 'cause I'm happy anyhow. As I go along life's journey, I'm reaping better than I've sowed. I'm drinking from my saucer, 'cause my cup is overflowed.
ain't got a lot of riches, and sometimes the going's rough. But I've got a friend in Jesus that makes me rich enough. I thank God for all his blessings and his mercy he's bestowed. 'Cause I'm drinking from my saucer, 'cause my cup is overflowing. I've been through some storms in life, and my faith has grown so dim. But all at once those dark clouds broke, and the sun, she shined again. Lord, won't you help me not to gripe or complain about the tough roads that I've hoed. I'm drinking from my saucer, 'cause my cup is overflowed. If I should go on living when the ray grows deep and rough, I won't ask for other blessings. How about you listen? I'm already blessed enough, and may I never be too busy to help another bear his load. I'll keep drinking from my saucer, 'cause my cup is overflowed. I'll keep drinking from my saucer, 'cause my cup is overflowed.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Brother Randy, come this morning. I can't sing it as good as Jerry Barr, but I'm going to tell you what, that song blessed me as I sang that. We all should realize today that we're blessed. And you know what? If you're blessed, you're blessed by the best. God doesn't give us leftovers. God doesn't give us seconds, but he'll give you seconds if you'll ask. But I'm thankful God's always there, aren't you? Thank God. Listen to me. If you're not blessed this morning, you ought to hit the altar because your wood's wet. Amen. I'm telling you, God's good to you this morning. It may not seem like it, but remember, it's always darkest right before dawn. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy, rest assured, is coming in the morning.
Pray for me. I'm heading for a city where I've never been before, and I know that I may stumble, falter on the way, but there's a friend who lead me. I won't have to go alone, and I'll keep holding to his hand till I get home, till I get home. I'll keep holding to his hand till I get home. He's the rock on which I stand. If I let him lead the way, I know I'll never stray. And I'll keep holding to his hand till I get home. I can see the lights, the shores and sights. I know I'm almost home, and I love his precious nail-scarred hands. Lead me on the way. If you're wondering, friend, how to make it in, I know he'll see you through. Just keep holding to his hand, and you'll get home. Till I get home. I'll keep holding to his hand till I get home. He's the rock on which I stand. If I let him lead the way, I know I'll never stray, and I'll keep holding to his hand till I get home. If I let him lead the way, I know I'll never stray, and I'll keep holding to his hand till I get home.
God bless.
A wandering soul traveling a well-worn road, a sinner so far from home, no second chance in sight. I heard you call my name, I felt you lift my shame, and I made a vow that I'd spend the rest of my life loving my Jesus, showing my scars, telling my story of how mercy can reach you where you are. And I pray the whole world hears the cry of my tries to make you hide, whispers that same old lie, keep all your pain inside, cause no one will understand. The last thing this lost world needs is someone I'm trying to be, the truth that has just a broken man, loving my Jesus, showing my scars, telling my story of how mercy can reach you where you are. And I pray the whole world hears the cry of my stand face to face with the one who gave it all for me. May all I have to show be all that mattered most, making your great name known. May this be my only legacy, loving my Jesus. showing my scars, telling my story of how mercy can reach you where you are. And I pray the whole world hears the cry of my heart, is to see the ones I love, all the ones I love, loving my Jesus.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? Go ahead, Sissy. Bless your heart. Sure. Amen. Bless your heart. Bless your heart. Amen. Amen. Somebody else. Go ahead. Right. That's right. Amen. 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 That's right. Amen. Bless your heart, Sister Michelle. Anyone else? Micah, come sing God's Been Good. God's been good to you. You ought to rejoice in that this morning. You ought to thank Him for that.
Lately I've been looking back along these winding roads to the old familiar markers and the mercy I have known. I know it may sound simple, but it's more than I can explain. There's no other words to tell you than to say God's been good. In my life, I've been blessed beyond my wildest dreams as I go to sleep each night. See, I've had more gains and losses, and I've known more joy than hurt. I done messed up. Man, the Lord's been good to us this morning, church. See, I've been blessed far beyond my wildest dreams. You see, I've known more gain than loss. I've known more joy than... You see, I didn't have a good week this week, church. I testified about on Wednesday. See, the devil fought me hard this week. He fought me. It may be the hardest that the devil's ever fought me, but can I tell you that there's victory in it? When the devil starts fighting, can I tell you that there's victory? When the Lord says that there's victory, when the devil's done fought you as hard as he can, when the devil's come at you with all that he's got, can I tell you that the Lord says, just hold on a little longer, son. Just hold on, because there's victory that comes in the morning, church. I got to restart. First, I used the wrong key, and the Lord's working this morning, church. Lately I've been... No, that ain't right either, church. Pray hard this morning. Lately I've been looking back along these winding roads to the old familiar markers and the mercy... That's... Lord, help us this morning. Looking back along these winding roads to the old familiar markers and the mercy I have known. I know it may sound simple, but it's more than I can explain. There's no other words to tell you than to say God's been good. in my life. I've been blessed beyond my wildest dreams as I go to sleep each night.
Sure, I've had my share of hard times.
By my side, he's always stood. And through it all, God's been good. Times were playing, I can see, when I've cried those bitter tears. Oh, but I felt his arms around me as I faced my darkest fears. See, I've had more gains than losses, and I've known more joy than hurt as his grace fell around me. Undeserved, God's been good in my life. I've been blessed beyond my wildest dreams as I go to sleep each night. See, I've had my share of hard times. By my side, he's always stood. And through it all, God's been good. Amen.
Amen.
He's been good to us.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Anybody else this morning? God sure is good to us. Thank God. Bless you, Mom. Yeah. Amen. Yes. Yes. Sure. Amen. Bless your heart. Amen. Brother Jim?
You know, with this COVID thing and everything that, you know, we're kind of, I know everybody has their own choice to come to church or not, but just in Hebrews chapter 10, and Mark said this many, many times, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as a matter of some is, but exhorting one another.
Yeah.
And so much the more as you
see
the
day
approaching.
Sure.
You know, I'm glad for the internet that people can stay home and watch the service, but I don't think they're going to feel the service like I have today.
Bless your heart.
That God's blessings come down, and this verse in the Bible just witnesses to it that you have to come together and worship together.
Amen.
And you will get this blessing that we've got today.
Sure.
That was so wonderful. That Mark asked for the crack of the window of heaven, and he's cracked it today.
Sure.
And blessed our hearts.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. You know, God will do it if you ask him. When you ask him, better make sure you believe it, though.
Amen.
Hey, as Charles DeBoer would say, don't take an umbrella if you're going to pray for rain. Don't expect it to happen. Amen. If you pray for rain, expect it to rain. Amen. Anyone else? Bless your heart.
And he passed away a
sure. Bless your heart. Amen. Sure. Amen. 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 Anyone else? 2 Corinthians is where we're going to be this morning. Chapter number 11. 2 Corinthians chapter number 11. I'm going to read one verse. And then once I read the one verse, I want you to turn to Genesis chapter number 3. Now, I need you all, those of you that believe in the power of prayer, I need you to pray for me this morning. Those of you that don't, I want to pray for you. The reason I say that is that the Bible says the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And I know a lot of us like to use that word righteous and put it somewhere up here, but righteous is nothing other than being right with God. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm right with God this morning. If you're not, you can be. If you're not, you need to be. If you're not, you can be. Today. Right now, today is the day of salvation. So if you have found your place, I want to read one verse. If you would please honor the Lord and stand with us. Chapter number 11, 2 Corinthians, verse number 14. 2 Corinthians, chapter 11, verse 14. If you're there, would you please say amen? Now notice what the Apostle Paul is writing to the church at Corinth. He says, "And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light." That's all I'm going to read, but I want to read it again. "And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light." Father, we thank you for this opportunity. God, if there's ever a time that I need you, right now is it. God, you know the struggles that I have been struggling with this week concerning this message. God, we know how the enemy has done everything within his power, Lord, that we wouldn't preach this message. God, we know that as we study, our minds would not focus. God, when we would read, the words was not understood. And God, we're seeking a great, great vision from God this morning. God, an unveiling from heaven, if you will. God, you know our hearts. God, I'm asking you right now that you would open the ears and the hearts of the men and women, boys and girls that are here. And Lord, I pray that you would do a work as only you can do. God, help us to see what is happening around us. And Father, I pray, God, that we'll all give you honor, glory. We ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. And you may be seated. Now, before I have us go to the book of Genesis chapter number 3, I want to reread that passage of Scripture there in verse number 14. Notice Paul says, "And no marvel." What Paul is saying here is simply this: don't be surprised. In other words, do not let it surprise you that Satan himself, the devil, the one-eyed burger monster, the prince of this world, whatever it is you want to call him, do not let it surprise you that he himself, what is it going to say, is transformed into an angel of light. Now notice this. He did not say that Satan might be transformed. He did not say that Satan could be transformed. But he says Satan is transformed into an angel of light. Now, what does that mean, Pastor? Well, thank you for asking. I believe it simply means this: that the devil is doing his very best to kill, to steal, and to destroy. He's doing everything within his power to cause God's people to get their eyes focused off of God and onto the things of this world. But can I tell you this? Jesus said this, "And look up, for your redemption draweth nigh." Can I tell you this? Jesus is coming one day after a while, and it could be today. I have no idea. But my friend, the question I've got for you today is, if he should come, are you ready? You see, the devil will tell you that you have another opportunity. The devil will tell you you have next week. The devil will tell you that you're good enough. But can I say this? Be not deceived. God is not mocked. I want to preach a message with God being our helper today. I would like to preach it this. Be careful. Be careful. Be very, very careful. When Paul makes this statement, and when I was reading this statement, we've heard this passage of Scripture read many, many times. We've seen it preached. We've preached it ourselves. But it wasn't until the time that I see what is happening all around us in this life, and it seems as if the closer I get to God, the harder that the enemy attacks. And you know, that's what his job is. It should not surprise us. Things are wrong in our lives. Things are wrong in this world. Would someone agree with me this morning? There is a way, the Bible says in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 14, verse 12, there is a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. That tells me this, that people can be deceived. People can be deceived. Can I say this? If people can be deceived, that means the world can be deceived. And sadly is this, God's people as well can be deceived. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 13, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. I believe today that people are being deceived. They're being told that everything is going to be all right. They're being told this, that you have a long time before the Lord comes back. They're telling you this, you really don't need to repent. You really don't need to give your tithes. You really don't need to go to church. And you should really pay attention to what's going on around you. Can I tell you this, my friend? The only thing that we should be paying attention to is the Lord Jesus Christ, because he has all things under his rule and thumb. The Lord's coming back. The Bible, matter of fact, tells us in the book of 1 John chapter 4, verse 1, that you and I, as God's people, the Christians, those that believe in Jesus Christ, should test or try the spirits. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 1, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. And it's no secret here today that Satan would love to take you out. He wants to kill you. He wants to kill your grandchildren. He wants to kill your children. He wants to kill the church. He wants to kill pastors. He wants to kill preachers. He wants to kill lay members. He wants to kill anybody that will listen to him. And you know, sadly, this is what's happening. People are falling by the wayside. They're giving up on God. They're not learning to trust like they once used to. Can I tell you this? It's time for God's people to look up. Bless God. Look up. The Bible says in John 10:10, the thief cometh not before to steal, kill, and destroy, but he says, I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. We live in a humanistic world. Well, preacher, what does that mean? Well, it means this. If it feels right, it must be right. If it feels right, it must be right. Or if it makes sense, it must be right. You know, that's not what the Bible says. I looked up the definition of what humanism means, and it means this. It is a doctrine or an attitude or a way of life that focuses on humans and their interests and or their feelings and or values. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't always feel saved. But by faith, I know that I'm saved. If we went on feeling, most of us would not be here today. Would you agree with me? We'd stay in bed. Listen, I heard someone come in this morning. I'm so tired this morning. And here's the thing. I know it's the enemy. Why? Because it's the Lord's day. And the devil knows where you ought to be on the Lord's day. You ought to be in the house of God, not forsaking the assemblings of yourselves, as the matter of some is. But can I tell you this? We ought to be, listen to me, church, seeking and looking up, for Jesus is drawing nigh. Book of Romans chapter 1 says this, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. And they changed the glory of an uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man. That's what humanism is. We look to man more than we do God. And the Bible goes on to say, in birds and the four-footed beasts and creeping things, wherefore God hath gave them up unto uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts. In other words, God says this: if that's who you want to serve, you go ahead and serve. But I want to be like Joshua. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. The Bible goes on to say, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Notice this: who changed the truth of God into a lie. The world will tell you there's more ways to get to heaven than one, but Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. The world will tell you, listen to me, if it makes sense, it ought to be right. But God says, don't go on your sense, don't go on your wisdom, don't go on what you know, but look up and trust me, I know the way. He goes on to say, they serve the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Can I say this? We need to be careful. Be careful. That's the title of today's message. The devil is on a warpath. And can I tell you this? The devil is sitting back. He's got his arm. Listen, he has not got a pitchfork and two horns out of his head. He comes to mankind with the most beautiful thing that you've ever seen, the most enticing thing that you've ever seen. The Bible says he is the deceiver. The Bible says he is the accuser of the brethren. He'll make you feel low. He'll make you feel as if you are of no use. But can I say this? If you're in Christ, you may not mean much to this world, but you mean something to God. I may not mean much to you today, but thanks be to God, I mean something to him. He saved me. He came, listen, picked me up, wiped me off, dusted me up, and guess what? Glory to God, he set me upon a solid rock. Hey, and that rock that I'm talking about is Jesus Christ. Hey, listen, I may not mean much to this world, but that's okay. I may not mean much to this community, but can I say that's okay? I may not mean much to you in my family, but can I tell you that's okay? But I do know this. I mean something to God, and you do too, blessed be to God. God loves you this morning, so be careful. Be careful. Be careful what enters your ears. Be careful what you allow your eyes to see. Be careful what enters into your heart. Now, I want you to turn with me to the book of Genesis, chapter number 3. Be careful. Remember that. Be careful. And remember that, no, don't marvel, Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. So how is Satan, how is the devil doing these things? What does he do? Well, let me bring you up to where we are here. I'm going to read a little bit in chapter number 3, verses 1 through 6. And I want you to read with me. The Bible says, now the serpent was more subtle. Now, that word subtle means sly or deceitful. He's a trickster. In other words, he's going to get whatever he can. He's going to try to deceive you into believing what he's selling you. Be careful. Be careful. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Be careful what you listen to. Be careful what you see. Be careful where you go. Be careful what you do. Am I getting my point across this morning? You know what you ought to do? You ought to be careful. Amen. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field. Let me remind you that God formed Satan. The crooked serpent is what he called him. He called him to live and created him as a being, an angel in heaven, to worship him. He was in charge of music. Did you know that? So listen to me. You ought to be careful what you listen to when it comes to music. A lot of people don't believe that Satan can take and twist things around and make you to believe things that you don't even know what you're listening to. Be careful this morning. He's very deceiving. He's very cunning. He's very deceitful this morning. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. Right there it is. God made him. And he said unto the woman, yeah, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of every fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. For God knoweth that in that day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. Now I want you to take notice, who did that? Satan, the devil, Beelzebub, the prince of peace, the ruler of darkness, whatever you wanted to call him, it is Satan himself. And remember, Satan himself can come to you and present himself as an angel of light. He can make something so bad look so good. Are you with me this morning? He can take something that looks so good, but yet make it look so bad. Hey, listen to me, my friend. You live in the world that we live in today. You turn on the televisions, you talk to people. People want nothing to do with God. They want God cast out of the schoolhouse. They want him out of the White House. Hey, listen, and even want him out of your house. They want him out of the community. Can I tell you this? Without God, we cannot be blessed. And because of sin, God not and cannot continue to bless this country. People are being deceived. He is the accuser of the brethren. So how is he doing these things? Well, let me bring you up to where we are. Here in chapter number 2, we read where God created everything, right? And the Bible says on the seventh day that when he looked back, God just looked back in all of amazement and said, man, look at this. He said, it is good. And God was happy. And you know what? The Bible goes on to say that he created man. And the Bible says, listen to me, that he created man in his own image. And matter of fact, for all of you that don't believe that Jesus existed when God created man, can I just tell you this? The scripture tells us this. He said this, let us make man in our own image. God the Father, God the Son, and all glory, God the Holy Spirit, they've always been. They were there in the beginning, they're there today, and can I tell you this? They'll be there for eternity. Thank God, Jesus, God, the Spirit of God is everywhere. So we see that God saw that man, he created man, he made man in his own image, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. But you know what he said? He said, it's not good that man should be alone. So he caused a deep sleep to come on Adam. The Bible says he took out one of his ribs, and here comes woman. And Adam took it, and he saw her, and he said, whoa, glory to God, she's pretty. No doubt in my eyes. He looked and saw that Adam was beautiful, and he called her Eve because she come from the womb of man. Now we come to chapter number 3. But before we get there and before the woman was ever created, God gave Adam strict instructions. Adam, I'm giving you this. Isn't it beautiful, Adam? Adam, look at all the trees that we've planted. Look at all the fruit that these trees are. God, Adam, look at the river that's flowing down in the midst of this garden. Adam, I'll give you everything that you need to live in this life and be happy. You know, when God gives us something, he gives us the best. I believe that with all of my heart. So there is Adam, and you know, Adam's sitting there, but he saw there was something missing in Adam's life. But he said, now, Adam, listen to me. Of every tree that's planted in this garden, you can eat of it, you can do with it whatever you want, you take care of it, but that one tree right in the midst of the garden, he says, don't look at it, don't touch it, and surely don't eat it. You know what Adam said? Okay, I can do this. God caused the deep sleep to come on. He created Eve. Here comes Eve. He calls her Eve. They start living life happily. And here's the greatest part about their life. Every day at the same time, God walked with them in the cool of the day. Every day. And you know what? They were naked. And it didn't bother them. Didn't care. Could care less. You wonder why? Because they were focused on God. Be careful. Be careful. So now here comes along Beelzebub. Old Slewfoot, one-eyed booger monster. Satan himself, the devil. He comes, and you know what the first thing he does? He doesn't go to Adam. What does he do? He goes to Adam's helpmeet. And you know what he does? Listen to me. There's three things for you need to realize how the devil deceives us and how that the devil gets us focused off of God on the and the things that is happening all around us. So I'm telling you, be careful. The very first things he does, if you'll look with me at verse number 1 of chapter 3 and verse number 4, I want to read them to you. Verse number 1, it says, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman," now this is the devil, he's come to the woman. Yeah. Hey, has God said that you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? First of all, the devil comes to her in the form of a question, making her think. Hey, Eve, did God really tell you that you shouldn't eat of the tree, of the fruit that's in the tree in the midst of the garden? Hey, now notice her response in verse number 2. "And the woman, Eve, said unto the serpent," listen to me, "we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden." In other words, she said this, hey, listen to me, devil. Of every tree in the garden we could eat. He gave us permission. Oh, but listen, verse 3. "But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden." She's reminding Satan what God had already instructed, and she believed it in her heart because she told. You say, well, preacher, how did she know? Because Adam told her. You see, we want to change things. We rewrite history and do all these things. Listen to me. God has always established and set man the head over the house. You can say amen or you can say ouch. But the man has always held a place. It's our responsibility spiritually and physically, men, to take care of the women and children in your house. That's old-fashioned. It may be out of style, but I really don't care because it's what the Bible says. Oh, preacher, cultures have changed. Times have changed. Yes, but God hasn't. He created man, then woman. The devil comes to the woman. And you know why he come to the woman? Now, let's be honest, men, because we have a hard time giving in to the wives. Now I don't want that to sound mean. Actually, we do give in to the wives. We'll do whatever our wives tell us. You want to know why? Why are you all sitting back there so quiet? Because you know this, a happy wife is a happy life. Amen. You can laugh all you want to, but I'm telling you, it is the truth. And I thank God for the wife that God has given me. I don't want to get off the subject, but here comes Satan. He comes to the woman. He says, now listen to me, Eve, has God really said that you couldn't eat of the other trees? And she said, yes, the trees, which is in the midst of the garden, God has said you can't eat of it, but notice this, neither shall you touch it. So she knew the dangers of the tree in the midst of the garden. But here, listen to me, the devil didn't give up. Now, let me tell you this, friend. He'll never give up on you. I don't care if you're saved. I don't care if you're lost. If you're lost and you've never known God, he'll make things of this world be so good to you that you'll refuse to want anything to do with God because this is his world. And to the Christian, he'll cause you to do things. He'll cause you to think things. He'll cause you to go places that you never thought you would go. But if you continue to look in verse number 4, he said, "And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die." So you know what the devil, the very first thing the devil does to us as his people, as God's people, he causes us to question God. He causes us to question God. And when we begin to question God, listen to me, our faith, the faith that you have established in the God of the heavens and the earth, it begins to diminish, it begins to fail, and before you know it, you stop looking at God the way that you once did, and you started looking and questioning if God is really the God that you thought he was. She said, listen, Satan was basically saying, are you sure that's what God said? She said, yes, all over the trees. All the trees we can eat, but not that one in the middle. We can't even touch it. But the devil, being persistent, said this, you shall not surely die. And when that happened, she began the moment of questioning God. Well, maybe, see, some of you here today is questioning God. Well, God can't answer that prayer. Well, I can't do these things, but God said I can do all things through Christ. Well, preacher, you don't know my life. There's no way that God could ever save me. But the Bible says, whosoever will, let him call upon the name of the Lord. Thou shalt be saved. As a Christian, you can say, preacher, you don't understand. I've messed up. I've given to temptation, and I've faltered, and I've failed. Can I tell you this? You're not alone. I've done the same thing. But God's word says this, that he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. He's a liar, and he's the father of it. Today you're questioning if you could be saved because you look at your life and you see how rotten that you've been, but yet God says, I love you so much, just come. So right now God is wanting you to come, but the devil is wanting you to question if God is really real. If God was really real, then I would have this or I would have that, or God, you would do this or you would do that. Listen to me, maybe God is just waiting on you. A little of this won't hurt me, we say. A little bit of sex won't hurt me. A little bit of drugs won't hurt me. God can't save me. God can't forgive me. God's not able to perform that miracle, but God is able. That's what the Bible says. How serious is God with sin? Notice this. Look up here. It was just a piece of fruit. How serious is sin? When God says don't, God means don't. If God says thou shalt not, God means thou shalt not. People want to get into an argument whether it was a banana, an apple, or an orange. I don't have no idea. The Bible just says it's a fruit, and it's not what kind of fruit it was. The fact of the matter is this, God says don't touch it, don't eat it, don't even look at it. But when the devil comes and he makes it appealing, you can't help but look at it. You can't help but taste it. Why? Because there's pleasure in sin, but only for a season. So the first thing the devil does is he causes us to question who God is. The Bible in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 22 says this, abstain from all appearance of evil. Now, what part of that did you not understand? Preacher, is it okay if I do this? Well, let me ask you, is it evil? Well, it could be. Well, then why are you asking? What's the end results of what you're asking me about? Abstain from all. Remember, it was just a piece of fruit. A fruit. They give up their lives for a piece of fruit because it was appealing. Because the devil sold them a piece of fruit that said this, you'll become as a god. You'll be exalted. You'll know right from wrong. The first thing he does is he causes us to question God. Secondly, look with me at verse 4 and 5. The Bible says, and the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. For God knoweth in that day that ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. The second thing that the devil would cause us to do, not only would he cause us to question God, but the second thing that he would cause us to do, it's to justify our actions and focus on us and not him. Notice what she did in verse number 5. For God knoweth in the day that they eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Look at the first part of verse 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food. You know what she did? She got her eyes off of God and got them onto herself and how that she thought that it would benefit her. She began to justify her actions. If it feels good, if it makes sense, it must be right, right? But God says there is a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. She saw, she focused on how she thought it would make her better, but she was just justifying her actions. Let me give you a short, quick story. How Satan works. Back in 2001, I was offered a position at work. My wife and I had prayed to God that God would make a way for her to stay at home. We had a daughter. We had no idea that we were having twins. To make a long story short, went to the doctor, found out we was having twins. We began the process of praying. Trish didn't want to go back to work. So you know what the devil did? He dangled a little carrot in front of me. to this old rabbit. Called into the office at corporate, offered a position at work, making double what I made right now. You know what? The first thing that enters my mind and in my heart, God, you've answered the prayers. We've been asking. You've delivered. You financially, my wife don't have to work. We'll be better off than what we were. But you see, I was focusing on what I saw, not the realistic things of what was going to happen. Preacher, what are you talking about? You see, I took that job. And you know what? I spend the majority of my time every week in Detroit, Michigan, at a warehouse. I was told that I would only have to go there once a month for a day. I had three warehouses to run. I said, well, that's not so bad. You know what? I saw the money. I saw that Tricia didn't have to go to work. And I saw that it was going to help us financially, physically. But what I failed to realize that it was destroying my spiritual life. I was a youth pastor at that time. I had dedicated my life to that church. I dedicated my life to Christ. I was there every Sunday morning, every Sunday evening, and every Wednesday evening, and every extracurricular activities. I was a youth pastor. I did this. I did a lot of things, not to feather my cap, but I was involved in the church. I was working in the church. But soon after I took this job, those things began to diminish. I couldn't be there Sunday morning or Sunday night because I had to be in Detroit, Michigan the first thing Monday morning, so I had to leave and be there. Wednesdays, I was caught up in Michigan on Wednesday, so I couldn't be home on Wednesdays. So guess what it was affecting? My spiritual life. I wasn't being fed. Oh, but that's not all. It began to affect my marriage. You see, my wife is at home raising twin baby boys with a daughter by herself. With no help from dad, the one that God had gave these children to, the daddy that was there and said, God, I'll do whatever you want me to do. But I saw what was good for the flesh, but yet didn't see how spiritually damaging it was. I watched my marriage deplete. I watched my relationship with my wife be non-existent. I watched my relationship with the church and my pastor be non-existent because I wasn't there. That's not it. Every time that I'd come home on the weekends, my wife would, with excitement, would tell me what my baby boys had done this week. Guess who wasn't a part of their lives? Daddy. The daddy that God had chose to be a daddy to those boys and that daughter. And I remember in Detroit, Michigan, in Livonia, Michigan, on a Thursday evening, I said, God, would you please get me out of this? Because I know what I need to be doing. When God got me to that place where I surrendered everything to God. Now listen to me. Let me show you how God works. God said, okay, but I'm doing this because you now realize what you've done. They were making cuts at that time. I was afraid I was going to lose my job. You know, that's what happens. They called me in the office. They said, listen to me. Would you be willing to go back in Columbus, Ohio, in the warehouse and manage that warehouse? I said, absolutely. I'll clean the toilets if you want me to. I just don't want to be in Detroit, Michigan anymore. He says, don't worry about that. We're going to bring you back into the warehouse. We're going to let you manage that warehouse. And here's the great part. We're not going to take any money away. Glory to God. You see, that may not mean much to you, but that means God taught me a very, very valuable lesson on the importance of serving God and trusting God and giving God everything that you've got. And you know what? God has never let me down. Though I failed Him many times, God has never let me down. The Bible says, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away and enticed of his own lust. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. You know why? I was sitting in Detroit, Michigan, dying spiritually. My marriage was failing. And my relationship with the church and my pastor had diminished. Oh, but God was still faithful. Somebody must have been praying for me. Somebody must have been on their face saying, God, would you help him to realize the importance of putting you first? You see, I didn't see it. See, that's what the devil does. He will cause you to question God. Not only will he cause you to question God, he will cause you to justify your actions. You ever notice this? When you find yourself in a pickle and you've done wrong, who's the first person that you call? It's never the pastor. It's someone you know that'll agree with you. Am I right or wrong? You'll call them because you know what they're going to say. Oh, I've got myself in this issue. What should I do? Well, just do whatever you feel is right. But that's not what God said. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these things shall be added unto you. Be careful. Be careful. See, I've been there. I can only preach this because I've been there. I know what the enemy can do. I know what the enemy is doing. And can I tell you this? The devil is causing God's people to question who God is in this time of turmoil. Can I tell you this? God is still the same God today as he was yesterday. God is still on the throne today as he was some 2,000 years ago. And can I tell you this? He's coming back. Hallelujah. He's coming back. And thirdly, in closing, not only will he cause us to question God, not only will he cause us to justify our own actions and focus on ourselves, this is the most dangerous, and this is the problem that we're seeing all around us. The devil will cause you, look with me at verse number 6, and the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eye, and the tree to be desired to make one wise. She took of the fruit, and she did eat. But notice this, and she gave also to who? Her husband with her, and he did eat. You know what the third thing the devil will cause God's people to do? Deceive others. You see, Adam's not to blame here. Yes, he is. Well, it was the woman's fault. She started it. Can I tell you this? When you stand before God in judgment, I won't be there with you. Your wife won't be there with you. Your husband won't be there with you. Your parents will not be there with you. Your friends will not be with you. The Bible says when you stand, for all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. When you stand before God, it will be you and God, and you and God alone. Nobody else will be able to have your case. But if you're saved, can I tell you this? You can look to the author and finisher of your faith. You can look to your lawyer. His name is Jesus Christ, and say, God, I have nothing to say. I refer all questions to my lawyer. Oh, don't that excite you? You won't have to say a word, because he is your propitiation. Can I tell you this? If you say something, you're just going to mess it up, because you've done messed it up anyways. The third thing the devil causes us to do is deceive others. That's why we'll pick up the phone and try to justify our actions with somebody we know will be in agreement with us. Can you believe that pastor preached that message? And I know he was talking about me. Oh, yeah, well, I thought the same thing. Who does he think he is? But you realize this, that a man of God, a true anointed man of God, don't sit back and point people out and say, you, my friend, or you, my friend. It's for all. You have to search your own heart, as David would say. Well, preacher, you basically told it was me. The only thing you didn't say was my name. You ever been there? I've been there. Trust me, I know. The preacher's gotten done, and I went up to him and said, my gosh, how did you know? You ever been there? Hey, it's not that man knows, but God knows everything. And God will use the man. So what happens now? What happens now? Well, here's what happened. Woman, hey, God, Adam, Eve, they weren't there. Remember, they used to walk every day with God in the same time, the same place, in the cool of the day. Weren't there. But God already knew where they was at. Adam, where you at? Right here, Lord. Why are you hiding? Because we're naked. Well, who told you you were naked? Here comes Eve. Eve, what'd you do? Well, old Satan over there. Hey. You all know you want to blame somebody else for your wrong. The woman blamed Satan. It was him. He's the one. He tricked me. He deceived me. Well, man, what's your excuse? Well, God, I'm blaming her. She's the one that gave it to me. Oh, and by the way, God, you gave her to me, so I'm blaming you too. So the man blamed the woman and also God. Can I tell you this? When we stand before God, you will stand on your own account. But bless God, you better be thankful. You better be honored. You better hope that Jesus Christ is on your side when you stand before God. The devil, my friend, he will cause you to question God. The devil, my friend, will cause you to justify your actions and focus on yourself and not him. And then thirdly, the devil will cause you to deceive other people. You see, that's what's happening in today's society. No one wants accountability for the wrong. Matter of fact, people don't even know what's right or wrong. The Bible says, woe unto a man that speaks good for evil and evil for good. Can I ask you this question in closing this morning? Have you been deceived? Have you been trying to justify your actions? Has the devil come along to you and caused you to question God? Can I tell you this? It's time to look up. As we stand this morning, as the girls come to get a song, I'm not going to tarry long. I don't know your heart, but I do know this, that God is able. Now, as everyone has bowed their heads this morning,